We present a conversation between Eric Hoffer and James Day.
Eric Hoffer takes pride in the fact that before he is anything else, he is a working man. A man who was thrown overnight, so he says, from the cradle to Skid Row. Born in New York City of Alsatian immigrant parents, he was to lose his sight, his memory, and his mother at the age of 7. His father at the age of 18. Almost without funds, but with his sight recovered, he moved to California to work at a variety of jobs, as a laborer and a migratory farm worker, and for the past 21 years, as a longshoreman on the San Francisco waterfront. Deprived of his formal schooling by the 8-year blindness, he taught himself to read both German and English, and has satisfied a voracious appetite for books by haunting public libraries wherever he has traveled. From this reading, and from his experience among working men and what he calls the misfits of society, he has drawn pungent and perceptive generalizations upon men and their motives. These form the basis of his 3 widely acclaimed books. The first of these, published in 1951, is The True Believer, a study of mass movements and the role of the fanatic. The second, entitled The Passionate State of Mind, is a collection of aphorisms, a 17th century style of writing most favored by Mr. Hoffer. His most recent book, published in 1963, The Ordeal of Change, continues his studies of man's motivations and examines the crisis of self-esteem which faces each of us when confronted by change. Mr. Hoffer, The True Believer was your first book. It's now been 15 years since it was published, and I suspect that probably the beginnings of this go back still further, do they not?
Yeah. Well, I actually became interested in mass movements during the Hitler decade. But I started to write The True Believer in 46, and I finished the first draft in 48. I remember that because I started it during the waterfront strike. 46, we had 3 months strike, and I finished it during the 48 strike, another 3 months. You know, Mr. Day, I've never taken off time to write, and I've been receiving some letters from people who got the idea that that's easy to work and write, but actually when I look backward, I can see that that any time I had to put a book in shape, you know, get really started or wind it up, see, I needed leisure. Now, we had these strikes in 46 and 48, but The Passionate State of Mind, for instance, I put in shape when I broke a thumb and I was 4 weeks off. And the last book, I broke a rib and I was 5 weeks off. So, well, anyhow, the first draft, I was in 48, then I took off a year. No, I didn't take off a year, but I spent a year. Mm-hmm. 1949, reworking the book. Harper accepted it in 1950, and the book was published early in 1951.
Do you think that your own thinking on these problems has advanced any in those 15 years since the publication of the book?
Well, Mr. Day, I've been thinking all my life, seems to me so, and yet I really don't know the first thing about the process of thought. All I know is that a train of thought grows. You don't know how it grows. It just grows by itself. And the way things worked out, I'm beginning to believe that I just have one train of thought. One train of thought. Maybe this is true of all people. Maybe everybody has only a central preoccupation, one train of thought. And no matter what we do later on, it's the same train of thought growing, pushing its way out. You know, I think Santayana said that that the first book of an intuitive person contains in it all the seeds of later development. There, see. Now, when the True Believer was published in 1951, I thought that I was done with the mass movements, you know. I became interested in the backward countries. You remember that time there in the 1950s, early 1950s, there were new nations popping up all over the place. And as a naive American, I asked myself a simple question. I said to myself, now these backward countries, what are they trying to do? Well, they are trying to modernize themselves. They are trying to modernize themselves in a hurry. They are trying to build roads, factories, towns, hospitals, schools. Now, all these things are sober, practical things, you know. And yet, when you look at those nations there, you see them doing these sober, practical things in an atmosphere of a madhouse. See, and I asked myself, why is it necessary? Why should it be necessary to stage a madhouse in order to produce these simple things? To me, it seemed almost simple. I'm convinced, you know, that if you took a group of Americans, you know, and you drop them anywhere there, see, they will be able to build a town or build a road, and in a matter-of-fact way, without any excitement, without any enthusiasm, and without staging these fantastic spectacles that you see all over Asia, Africa, in Cuba, or anywhere else. You know, this, my conviction, you know, that Americans can do these things there is probably exaggerated, and yet it comes from experience. I remember Mr. Day, during the Depression, a construction company, for some reason, sent down two trucks on Skid Row. And anybody who could climb up on that truck was hired. See, they scooped us out of Skid Row and put us on these trucks. And the trucks drove out to the San Bernardino Mountains. They dumped us on the side of the hill. And here we found all kinds of bundles of equipment. The company had only one man. We were going to build a road. And then we started to sort ourselves out. We had so many electricians, so many carpenters, so many blacksmiths, so many cooks, so many foremen. And before we knew, we had the tents up, the meals cooked. We organized ourselves. We went to work. And I was sure that if we had to write a constitution, there would be one of us who knew all the whereofs and wherefores, and we could have rebuilt, we could have recreated America, a whole of America right there on the side of the hill, and we were just the scum of the earth, you know. You might say that a shovel full of slime was scooped off the skid row there. And so to me, building a town, building a road, building a country seems almost a simple thing. You remember Mr. Day? Some years ago, the labor government, Atlas labor government, tried to raise groundnuts and peanuts, you know, in Africa, and they made an awful mess out of it. And I heard a bunch of longshoremen talking. One of them said, "For $1 million, I could raise peanuts on the surface of the ocean there." And he would have. He could have. I mean, there is a tremendous feeling, you know, of competence, of ability to do things, Desi. And you see it everywhere here in this country.
This is the practical sense you spoke of.
Yeah, it's the practical sense, and we ought to discuss this practical sense, because this is it's a fascinating subject, and it's not as simple as it sounds. But, as I said, I became interested in these backward countries, Desi. And I tried to find an answer, or several answers, as you see in the Ordeal of Change, you know, to these question, why this clamor, why this madness, you know, in order to do simple things. And after trying all kinds of answers, and some of them good there, see, I finally stumbled on the fact that change by itself, you know, is a terrible thing. You know, and this was very hard for me as an American to realize, because we take change in our stride, we take change for granted, we think change is easy, we think change is good. And it took really, as you'll see in the Ordeal of Change, I derived my insights from very slight experiences. Now, for instance, I was speaking peace for 3-4 months, and then all of a sudden I had to switch to picking string beans, and I remembered how hesitant and diffident I was that first morning when I was about to address myself to the string bean vines, so that the switch from peas to string beans was also a frightening thing there. And by some effort there, see, I could live myself into this experience of change, the frightening thing of it. You could almost say that broken habits, you know, are as disturbing, as upsetting as broken hearts, broken spirits, see? And I worked, you know, I worked on this, the Ordeal of Change, developing all these theories there, see? And the theories of change. I tried to show that when a population is subjected to drastic change, you are actually getting a population of misfits, see? Because we cannot prepare ourselves, you know, for the wholly new, for the unprecedented. So inevitably, see, the moment any country is subjected to drastic change, you have misfits, see? And once you have misfits, they will act and perform only in an atmosphere of passion. Of course, the very fact these nations are unskilled also generates heat, generates fervor, generates heat again. Now, in other words, the passionate state of mind, Mr. Day, is a substitute for skill. It's a substitute for confidence. You can see it on the waterfront. You take, for instance, an experienced longshoreman. He goes about his job as if at play. On the other hand, you take a greenhorn, a man who just come there, we call him a cherry there, see? He has to move around and do things as if he was going to save the world, if he's going to do anything at all. So this too is a factor. And then again, you have, the countries are poor, you know. In other words, they can't pay people, you know. They can't offer people tangible incentives to make them work, see? And therefore they have to make them work for words. They have to make them work for hope, for pride, for honor, and all these things there. And all these makes it necessary, you know, that makes it impossible, let's say, for those nations to perform at room temperature. They need enthusiasm. They need fervor. And Mr. Day, only after I finished that Ordeal of Change did I realize that all this time, you know, I was actually developing and amending The True Believer, the book on mass wounds. Imagine, here I wrote a book of mass wounds. I've been thinking about the subject for almost 20 years, and it never occurred to me that change by itself is a cause of mass movement. In The True Believer, all I say is that revolutions are instruments, you know, for the realization of drastic change. It never occurred to me that there cannot be no mass movements, you know, where there hasn't occurred change, where things haven't changed at all, revolutions don't take place at all. Change comes first, and the revolution is a byproduct of change. So after all this thing was done, I realized that I was still writing The True Believer. Well, when all this was done, I became all of a sudden interested in another subject. You see, I'm actually convinced now that no matter what my new interest is going to be, I'll be still working on The True Believer. Even if I get interested in cooking or astronomy, The True Believer is pushing out. This is a fantastic thing to me. I mean, this growth, this train of thought that it's coming out, it's trying to get out there, no matter what I do. Now here, several years ago, I became interested of all things in juvenile. Can you beat that? Me, a man in his 60s, who is naturally hostile to juveniles, at least hostile. I hardly ever meet them, you know. All I know about juveniles is what you read in the papers there, see? And judging by the papers, the juveniles are awful, you know. And here, all of a sudden, I became interested in juveniles. Now, how did it happen? It's really fantastic, you know. You remember Mr. Day, several years ago, there was a week during which the newspapers reported an epidemic of student riots.
Yes.
Starting in Istanbul, coming over to Tehran, then down to, I think it was Bangkok, and then you was Saigon, then you had Seoul, Tokyo, and it wound up in Mexico City, I think. And most of these student riots had an anti-American bias. And I remember one morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, as I was waiting for the bus, I saw the headline in the newspaper announcing one more student riot. And I remember I snorted and I said, bah, I said, history made by juvenile delinquents. And the moment the words came out of my mouth, Mr. Day, something clicked in my mind. Now, this click is not very frequent, but it's often enough that when I hear that click, see, I know that I'm plugged in, you know, that something connected in my mind. So I bought the paper and I got in the bus, but when I sat down the bus, I didn't look at the paper at all, you know. Things were coming together in my mind. Things I've read over the years, stray observations and experiences, and even thoughts that I formulated long ago.
That didn't fit in some cases.
But I asked myself, Who is making history? Is it the old who are making history? What role do the young play in making history? And I remembered, like I said, look, when I wrote The Passionate State of Mind, for some reason, I inserted an aphorism which reads like this. History is made by men who have the restlessness, impressionability, credulity, capacity for make-believe, ruthlessness and self-righteousness of children. It's made by men who set their hearts on toys. All leaders strive to turn their followers into children. Now, this insight came to me from observing two willful God children in action, you know, and of course, observing the antics of the Nazis and the communists. But the thought was filed away in my mind. It didn't integrate with any train of thought, but now I had a hunch that should be almost easy for me, you know, to make out a case that one can hardly know how things happened in history unless you keep in mind all the time that it's juveniles, that most of the time it's juveniles that made them happen. And I started to collect the facts. Well, you know, Mr. Day, that despite the psalmist 70 years, men's span of life until quite recently has been very brief. You know, the truly old are a very rare phenomenon in history. I read about the excavation of one of the most ancient cemeteries in the Near East. And the archaeologists found that the people who were buried there were, the average age of the people buried there was 25 years old at death. And there is no reason to believe that the place was particularly unhealthy. Well, this means tremendous thing. It means that the great inventions of the Neolithic age, you know, the domestication of animals and plants, the invention of the wheel, sail, irrigation, fermentation, even the calendar and the script was made by almost a childlike population. And you remember in the Ordeal of Change, I have a whole chapter on the playful mood suggesting that this is actually how those inventions were made. Then I thought to myself, these ancient legends too, you know, with their fairy tale-like pattern and their heavy sexual symbolism wasn't written by burnt out old men, you know. But even more recent periods, could hardly be understood unless you kept in mind that the chief characters, the chief protagonists of those periods were actually juveniles. Now, for instance, anytime you go to the Young Museum and you look at the armor, you know, the suits of mail that came down to us from the Middle Ages. Now, the thing that strikes you is that how small these things are, and you are convinced that the people who wore them were not grown-up persons, and indeed they weren't, you know. These people became men at the age of 13. I mean, they married at the age of 13. They became generals and leaders in their teens, and they were old men at 30 and 35. You know, the Middle Ages were a very poor time for the middle-aged. The troubadours and the historians make tremendous fun, you know, of all the middle-aged. And unless you keep in mind, you know, unless you know something about juveniles and juvenile and the pattern of juvenile delinquency, you could hardly make sense of those, of the flamboyance, the pageantry, the credulity, the ruthlessness, and the madhouse that was the Middle Ages. And things didn't change very much in the next period, in the 16th century. Montaigne says that he hardly ever met a man as old as 50. And Salvador de Madariaga, in his book on Spain's great age, that's 1550 to 1650, tells again that the men of that age were just teenagers, see? And the dramatists of that age, when they say that a man is old, they mean a man of about 40, yellow-skinned, wrinkle-faced, and or toothless, see? I also remember that towards the end, that in the 16th century, Charles V, became emperor at 20, Francis I became a king at 22, and I think Henry VIII became a king at 18. Now, just at this point, I began to suspect that I was on the wrong track. You see, it didn't seem to me that I'm going to spend the rest of my life glorifying the juveniles, showing that the juveniles did this and the juveniles did that. And it struck me right away. I said to myself, is the juvenile mentality confined to adolescence? Do people automatically grow up as they grow older? Are there not teenagers of every age? And I remembered something really remarkable, you know. You know, in 1502, Cardinal Giuliano della Rovere became a pope at the age of 62. And he took the name of Julius II in honor of Julius Caesar, whom he, a pope, considered the greatest man that ever lived, and whom he was determined to emulate. And so, on the threshold of old age, this glorious juvenile, Giuliano of 62, puts on a helmet and a cuirass, gets on a horse, and sets out to become a conqueror. So, clearly, I saw that where this train of thought is going to take me, see. I said to myself, clearly, at all times there are people who never grow up, who remain juveniles, perpetual juveniles all their lives. And there are times in which a whole population becomes a population of juveniles. They're being juvenilized. Here I came across, up against something new, you know, juvenilization. And particularly in the 20th century, look around you, Mr. Day. Look at all the present leaders, see. Khrushchev, Castro, Nkrumah. What's the name of that fellow in Indonesia?
Sukarno,
see. Why, how could you understand these people unless you realize that these are juveniles, you know? And if you know something about juvenile delinquency, you could almost predict what these people are going to do. And more. Nehru is not a juvenile, but Nehru is a schoolmaster. Have you seen how he talks to the parliament? He's just like a schoolmaster talking to retarded children. See, and a schoolmaster is at home, you know, in a world run by juveniles. By the way, today's newspaper will tell you that a new premier in northern Rhodesia, Kaunda was elected a schoolmaster again. See, so you actually have here a world run by juveniles and schoolmasters. And so here I was getting away from juveniles. I was getting into the concept of juvenilization. And I could see that I was sliding into the subject of mass movements, yes, step by step, see. I didn't know where I'm going to get in there, but I could see that my mind was tilted towards that subject there. See, no matter what, where I started, I'll go down there. I wind up in mass movements.
It begins to come right back to the beginning.
Yeah, that's right. And you see, I ask myself a question. I said to myself, this process of juvenilization, see, if I'm going to know anything about it, I have to find out how the juvenile state of mind arises in the adolescent, see. Now, I could not accept any idea, you know, that the juvenile state of mind in the adolescent is a function of anatomical or physiological conditions. You know, there is no evidence at all that the mind of a juvenile is different in structure, you know, from the mind of a mature person. And even if you knew that there are certain differences, how are you going to connect these differences with I said to myself, no, they. Juvenile state of mind, see, in the adolescent, is the result of the special situation in which the juvenile finds himself, see. And if grown-up persons are placed in somewhat similar situation, they'll behave like juveniles. Now, what is the chief characteristics of the adolescent's existence, see? It is that this existence is a phase of transition. A passage from childhood to manhood. And therefore, anybody placed in a similar position of drastic change, of drastic transition, will also manifest a juvenile state of mind. Therefore, the juvenile should have something in common with the emigrant who is passing from one country to another, or people of backward countries who are transferred from backwardness to modernization, or subjected people, serfs, slaves, turning into freemen, and people retiring even. I could see right away, Mr. Day, that I had a new approach to mass movements there, see, that I could actually include now, when I was going to talk now, if I were to write now The True Believer, and I was to write the chapter on, that's it?
No, huh? Don't finish the sentence,
yeah.
Please.
I would have a new classification, and it might be much easier for me, you know, to classify the potential true believers.
I think this has given us an insight into the whole process of thinking, and perhaps you'll want to discuss this further. If not,
sure.
I'd like to bring up another subject, and that is a subject I suspect of maturity, the subject of talent. I'd like to talk to you about that next time. Thank you very much.
You've just seen a conversation between Eric Hoffer and James Day, General Manager of KQED San Francisco.
This is NET, National Educational Television.